within, your real oneness within you, your faith, the Lord, who created the entire universe, He has given you. This body is the temple of the living God. If you go inside, you will reach your destination. If you are a spiritual man, and I tell you that there is nothing which holds us on this planet except our own mind. I tell you that it is necessary for us to understand our own mind so that we know how we can do it. This body expresses us from one to the destination. The body is supposed to stop us. It is created to stop us. In fact, the mind is what divides us from one to the creator of ourselves. Therefore, the mind is not being unfair, unjust. There is something wrong. The mind is doing its basic duty. The mind is supposed to work in this way in which it works. And therefore, if the mind engages us in the fulfillment of desires, in dark processes that distract us, in creating attachments from the world outside, in creating attachments to people outside, this is a natural function of the mind. We should not get surprised why the mind is doing like this. In fact, if the mind does not behave like this, then it is called for surprise. Therefore, this is the nature of the mind. The main message these mystics and masters have given us is, understand the true nature of your own soul, your own consciousness, and understand the true nature of the mind. When you understood both, you will be able to overcome the obstacle of the mind and find yourself. And after you find yourself, there is just one little step towards finding your creator. Because you are made of the same stuff that the Creator has made. You are that stuff, and the soul is made of the same stuff that the Creator has made of. That stuff is called love. That is why we are frequently referred to God as love. We have frequently heard that the path, the spiritual path, is the path of love. That no meditation can be successful unless you have meditation with love and devotion. And if a person mechanically does meditation all your life, you will get nothing if it is not done with love and devotion. And love and devotion is such an essential ingredient of calming the mind that anything less than that is just a ramification or an activity of the mind. We may be intellectuals, we may think a lot, we may read books, we may have notes, analysis of what the situation is, we may build up an imaginary structure of how this world is created, where the mind stands, where the soul stands, where the other regions, where the heaven and heaven, where is the Lord. We can do all that intellectually. It's just the mind is given, it leaves us nowhere. Only love takes us beyond the mind. Why does it happen? Because the mind functions through the ego, the I-ness. The ego is the great obstacle between our goal and our senses. Every obstacle has to be crossed. The mind does not function in this way. The mind takes on a very different form. The ego, I can do it. I will do it. I will achieve it. I can see what I have to do. This I becomes the very obstacle that one has to overcome. This I or ego is not very necessary. If we do not have ego, how could we be seekers? If we did not have another I, how could we find? Therefore, even to start the spiritual journey, we need the I. In order to be seeker of the truth, we need I. In order to take the first step, we need I. In order to make effort, we need I. If I is needed in so many steps of the spiritual path, where does it become lacking and become an obstacle? At what point does the human ego or metaphysics and master of spirituals, that the eye is naked and useful. I put the point that it puts us on the spiritual path. I understand that if you stay with the eye, you can't reach the destination for going. Because the eye will keep you engaged in yourself. And engaging in yourself means engaging in separation. Then you will give a new, more attractive definition of ego. This time, ego does not mean I. If your eye is the same as the wind of war, does the eye work? If your eye joins you with the divine will, then the eye is good. If the eye separates you from them, that eye is an obstacle. The distinction between this. A person who says, I am going to do it, no matter what happens, nobody can stop me. That person gets more success in the spiritual path. Because that person is already recognizing a separation from others. Nobody can stop me. That means I am separate from everybody else. All of my obstacles. I am going to make it on my own. That means there is no other way. Everything. But if a person says, how do I know that behind my actions, behind my thoughts, behind my will, is the will of the Spirit of God who created it? And there is really no difference between my will and the will of the Lord, because indeed we can do nothing except according to His will. Indeed, it is will that is the only will that prevails. Therefore, why do you submit to that will? When you understand how that will operates, and make the will of I and the will of the Lord the same. The same I becomes useful in the spiritual path. Ego has been described as the fifth passion, which puts us on the spiritual path. We are very familiar with the five passions. Lust, anger, greed, attachment, and ego. It is said that ego was last of all on the spiritual path. When we try to go on the spiritual path, other things are taken care of more easily than this. The ego that appears under me is this much progress as this. And yet I have done that much as this, and that becomes an obstacle. Ego can be very subtle. The person says, I am the biggest man in the world, and ego is easy to deal with. Everyone will tell you, I'm not. I'm not. And the person says, I am the nobody. That person is really different than the ego. There's nobody who will do anything. And why is that person saying, I'm the honest of the humble? Not of humility. Not enough is because of I not existing, but recognizing that it is a good thing to humble. The spiritual leaders have spoken of humility as a good thing. After the honest of the humble means I am humble. Which is the same people. And that is a subtle form in which we may not be able to overcome our own weakness. That is the way in which the mind through the ego can become a yoke, can become an obstacle. Spiritual goal can become a roadblock on our spiritual journey. And I mentioned last time, the component we need to have another emotion in our spirituality, so that ego can be wiped out through the experience of another emotion. If you consider your own lives, and say, what is the kind of thing that can make me forget this happiness and put me in another state? Take a look. We have been 7 years of our life, all of us were assembled here. We can remember our own episodes and incidents of life. So many times, we talk of, I want to do this, this is right, this is right. And we can so many times, where things happened in life, that I took a second place, or I have forgotten for a while. If you look
So I need to understand a place where the monarchs, when you experience love and devotion. There is nothing that makes one forget the eye as love. Love is the only experience in which the mind can take over your attention, take over your awareness, to the exception of eye. Every other mental activity keeps the eye in front. I can know it, I will know it, I will argue with you, I will explain to you. I will read this book, I will read this, I will talk to you, I will write there, I will hear here. I will remain in front. The whole activity, except the activity or the experience of love, where the eye takes a second place. And who takes the first place? The love. The one you love. If you actually have an experience of love, only takes a second place and the beloved comes first. There is nothing else that puts the other in the second place. There is no spiritual or worldly activity that puts only in the second place. That takes precedence over the ego, except love. Therefore, love is the answer. When we join mind and ego, and utterly and awareness, they are coming in a way of spiritual progress, then the answer is, do something which puts the eye, the ego, the mind, as a new place. And that is, have the experience of love. Now, the eye and the whole of us, the unity of our consciousness is faced with this problem. How do we have the experience of love? If you say, I am not going to have experience of love, I become supposed to gain. And what do you get in return when you say a thing like that? I am not going to love this person because he is so good. I am going to love this person, he is so kind. I am going to love this person, he is like my brother. When all these considerations come into your head, you are not talking of love. We are talking of creating an attachment. Your attachment, the experience of all the various challenges, and the rest of our lives. That is why a great distinction is made between attachment and love. Attachment is one of the five passions which are most difficult for spiritual journey. Love is the great leap forward in spiritual journey. So we have to distinguish between these. What experiences can we call attachments, and what experiences can we call love? All the masters are saying, love is an ordinary root to spirituality, and attachments is an obstacle. They are distinguished. Attachments are this way, yet you get half days today. Must be a big difference between them. The difference indeed is very significant. In attachment, we are conscious of who our thoughts and the one we are attached. If attachment is vague or little or not noticeable, then we and you are also not noticeable. If attachment grows, the awareness of I and you both grows. If attachment becomes very strong, awareness of I and you both becomes very strong. You will never experience attachment without a growing awareness of both I and you. We don't use the word love. We frequently do. I love you, 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 dear. You will use any of these phrases. When you experience this, or when you are experiencing this, what are you experiencing? You are experiencing I and you. And the more you are feeling it, the more you know all. That's a sign of attachment. Therefore, the more attachment you have, the more awareness you have. But love is distinguished from this. When love increases, the attachment shifts from one to the other. And when love increases, the awareness of I becomes less, the awareness of you becomes more. because when you increase his ability, you almost forget your own heavens on it. You forget who you are. You only know the better. Wherefore, life is an experience of oneness. Not togetherness. Your togetherness is attachment. Oneness is love. And that is not so standard. What are the fanatics? Only the way. As you want to experience oneness, experience love. If you want to experience togetherness, experience attachment. Attachment will keep you here, because attachment will still keep the ego in front of you. You will be surprised that even as people use the word Maya, and they keep on repeating this to have it told themselves that they are experiencing love. In fact, they are boosting their ego. And if the ego is slightly hurt by the beloved, the other party, not attachment, disappears, the so-called love disappears. The sign of attachment. This doesn't happen in love. Love creates the condition of there being no conditions. An unconditional friend for someone, concern for someone. You concern and grateful concern for yourself. You concern for someone that makes you forget for the current being what's happening to yourself. This great feeling of concern for another person, for doing yourself, is the true sign of love. One of the concern is going for another person, another concern for yourself, is it actually? Why is this kind of distinction existing in these relationships? I come out around the world and I find people use the word love for all these situations. They don't use the word attachment. Nobody says they're attached to swords. They have no attachment or any good thing. They don't have a flower. I love that person. I love my house. I love my children. I love my parents. I love everybody. They want to use the word love all the time. Why? Because I never say anything. They don't want to be embarrassed. But what is the distinction? The distinction between attachment and love is exactly as the distinction between the mind and the soul. No difference at all. Now, what is the distinction between mind and soul? There is between them, between the origin of the soul and the origin of the mind, between them, there is a certain order we call the mind. Kaya is the literal translation of the word divine. Divine interposes between the soul and the mind. The soul interposes. If you are descended from our father's home, to the physical realm of this world, we have passed through the stages of moving from spirituality to consummate your mental stage, to astral sensory stage, to the physical and material stage. And we can see ourselves now embodied physically, having the senses within them, and having your mental processes there in the center inside the soul in back. The process of this event, one is like snowballing with more and more of these love colors coming on top of us. Your soul is made of love. Same essence as the Lord. There's marriage and timelessness, spacelessness, consciousness. It goes down and erupted into these colors by time, by color, which puts the mind, gives it a time frame, the space frame, puts the senses, and makes it project outwards for all its desires. What's the body? And makes this physical world alone real. This is a very simple step by step scenario creating an emotional state where we are now. And remember, this is true. To go back to the original, we just reverse this. We become unconscious of the physical body. We will find that even when we are unconscious of the physical body, we are still fully conscious of senses. When we become unconscious of senses, to reality, we find that there was no separation, there was pure separation in us. Yet there was no primary spirit, so we would be separated. Considering this, would anybody be separated from anybody else if there was really no color and no space? Is there anything, certainly is there anything between us, or within anything, except from color and space? There is no separation except from color and space. Into this division. What is the division? Everything that can be perceived or experienced through mind, senses, and body, there should be a beginning, a middle, and an end. That's the beginning of time. And then we realize that when we are here, we find all the experiences which are mental, or sensory, or physical, and a beginning, a middle, and an end. Everything that you talk of as a beginning, a middle, and an end. Except the spiritual truth, which lies beyond time, and therefore there's no beginning, no middle, no end. Everything that can change as a beginning, a middle, and an end. And everything that must change except our consciousness or soul. So where that means, no beginning, no middle, no end. Because of this means beginning, middle, and end. Soul means no beginning, no middle, no end. Mind means beginning, middle, and end. Therefore, this situation has been created by our descent from the status of a pure soul in the spiritual world, coming in the company of the mind and the senses, talking about the physical body, and taking that which has to be real, in which nothing is real because everything is real. This is an illusion created by time. So wonderful is this illusion that in the Eastern literature describing this illusion, they have given a great possibility to time. They have said the greatest negative power that happened in us from the longer was time. Or time. And time has been there, nothing has happened in us from the longer. Therefore, the greatest illusion, the super illusion, is time. Now, is there something that can rise above it? Are there human experiences taking place over time, which can be called different spiritual experiences, which can be defined as real, which are only the beginning, middle, and end? Are there any such experiences? Only three such experiences that we can notice, and they can be created by the mind. One of them is love, the second is intuition. Third is beauty. When we have these experiences of intuition, love, and beauty, we trust every time. They come like a flash from nowhere. They do not follow the laws of cause and effect. They do not have any beginning, middle, and end. They are no duration. When the mind contemplates what has happened, it creates a duration for the contemplation. If you ever had a hunch, you have no mind of something, without knowing why and how. And did you know that sudden knowing had no duration at all? And then the mind started thinking about how could I know it? Can I sure can I rely upon it? And that was fine. And contemplation alone, the consideration of what happened, that's fine. That's mental. But the original knowing something intuitively is not that. No space. You can't even see where it came from. The same thing is true of love. When love suddenly enters our minds, no knowledge comes from it. It's not certain. It's not the difference. Therefore, love is a spiritual activity. Intuition is a spiritual activity. Beauty, it comes the same way. You start realizing beauty, it disappears. You start realizing love, it doesn't stay. do something like that too. In that moment, you get the spirit of the mind. Therefore, the level, the experience of love, and the distinct from the experience of attachment, is an experience beyond the comfort of nothing. And there is the true spiritual experience. That is why the masters came and walked upon this earth. And they gave this to the spiritual message that God is within you. They used only one method, the method of love. And that's it. If you have love and emotion in your heart, your meditation is successful. Because that makes you very fundamental effort into the realm of spirituality. So, spirituality has to be in mind. In this material world, in physical bodies, just having intellectual knowledge of this possibility, what can we do? That is the practical question we have to ask ourselves. If somebody would recognize only love is the goal, love is beyond the mind, love is beyond the left, that's the real goal, and once we have it, we'll get it. And when his grace comes, he will just pull us by himself. What are we going to mean by it? The practical question is, we are sitting in the physical body. We are taking this physical body as real. Because we have nothing else to take on as real. We have no other experience. We can only realize it is part of itself. We try to contemplate something, it looks unreal. Looks dreamlike. This looks unreal. It is verifiable by our senses. Sitting in the situation of a physical reality, sitting with a physical body, with a physical mind functioning 24 hours, it will never stop thinking. Doesn't give us a break, even one minute of life. Whether we are awake or sleeping, the mind will never stop thinking. So, just as we are, wanting inwardly, in our spirit, in our soul, to find that tomorrow, what can we do? Is there something in our hands? The mystics say, love is a gift. Okay? Shall I wait for a gift? They say, don't wait for a gift. How do you get a gift? How does a person give you a gift? A person is pleased with you and wants to give you a gift. Who are the people who give you gifts? No, it's not the nature of gifts. Christmas time, we get gifts, we get Christmas time, we get presents. How do you get gifts? Who gives you gifts? Those who love you give you gifts. And if you don't know how to love somebody, what can you do? And in the next 6 days, you can please those persons who can give you the gift. Please them. The second thing you can do is to appreciate. If you please somebody and appreciate what is already being done, you will get the gift of love. They give you a very practical task. They don't say that child is born with a capital meditation and you will be sent in practical life. If you start appreciating and if you start pleasing, you are very likely to be guided by a good gift of love. Now, who are we going to please and who are we going to appreciate? We are interested in the world right now. We want to be on the spiritual path and get the gift of love for the Lord and appreciate Him. Please Him. And that makes sense. How can you appreciate Him? Because everything that has been given to us has been given by Him. Do we appreciate it? Do we appreciate adequately? We don't have to appreciate for half a moment when He's missing it. We have to appreciate for the other appreciation of all. How do we appreciate? We appreciate in the greatest expression that we can find. We should have both holes wider when we appreciate what the Lord has given us. We appreciate the breath He's given us. We appreciate everything He's given us. But you will find young people, you will meet young life who are coming up with you. I am really grateful to the Lord. He gave me all this. He really took care of me. Look at their life. You see the sparkle of love in their eyes. And you will meet other people who are What is this? The effect that plays on you most of the realize. It has to be needed and expressed. Not only in the human language, but in all of the adventures that we expect from people. Our gestures, our vibrations. Some people are very careful of sin. They say, even in your sufferings. But you have all the kind of perception you really want that person. Yes, you have to say that people are like, what do you see on the internet? What was the name of the internet? That this is internet. This is lack of love. This is a mental gymnastics and experiences. Have you ever seen people who intellectually have everything, and you give everything, and you ask them for every question, and you want to run away from them? Of pain, each where the soul looks at it. When the illusion dies, the no someone is there. But overcome the loneliness, the storm, and the chance of the wind, and the weather then says, I don't get to the company you want. Just use your senses and go to the loneliness warfare. There's plenty of company in this world. And we go from place to place, we go. The Bishops and the reincarnation theory say that reincarnation is a continuous effort. I must travel in a bloody line to find a company to overcome loneliness. Nobody does this natural to the soul. And then you say, we are surrounded by people. We are surrounded by people we thought were our friends. We thought they were real. We thought we were really attached to them. We thought they were strong for us. Nobody is standing by us. It is only a temporary relationship. Nobody is ready to move. We are not. And this leading house, it's a sign of the spiritual seeking and a sign that is the time that we spread the Lord and overcome their loneliness. That is the time when love can be experienced by you. That's the best time to experience love. When the feeling of loneliness comes, and those very people, we thought were the best people in the world. They were closer to us. We depended on them. We lived with them, all of them. We were prepared for them. We thought they were going to survive for us. Now we find that was just a mental game. Yes, that looks like the custom of this world, the custom of the intellectual world, the custom of the mental world, the custom of the world of space and colors. That's not real. And you can go on. That's what you want. You have the real experience of love. So one is ready for the real experience of love by appreciating the Lord. Just by having a real experience of the Lord. And not only appreciating, you can appreciate by showing that it's nice, but by trying to please. When you try to please, you get the gift of love. So, very important question for us at this point. And they are very important and spiritual goals and life. And I'm trying to learn about that. People are very about the best that I mentioned. It's not that you don't need to be interested. We are interested in the Lord. Greater than each of us. Every one of us has gone to the Lord in every single one of us. Greater than one of us, every human being. Greater than all of us. What the story is that human being has received in us is a consciousness of that which lies within and our lack of consciousness. Or what is lying with it? We have a serious thought inside. The only thing about it is, but that particular human being, whom we now begin to refer to as the master, that human being has a condition of awareness of what is within him. And we have not yet awakened. If we become aware, what will happen? We will become exactly like that. We will not exist. That is why this master say, and the consciousness has already gone to the level of the consciousness of humanity. Associating with such a person does not bring us almost into better human beings, because he is not under the ordinary philosopher's stone. What is a philosopher's stone? A philosopher's stone. There is good in the world. There is our in the world. That is not. But a master in whom the consciousness is of the level of total consciousness. He does not convert people into better people, he converts them to the same level that he is. It's a philosopher's stone that earns every good philosopher's stone, but in the world. And the beauty of this, men are already equal in terms of protection, in terms of the possibility. All are equal, you can make it one. You need it ahead of us. You are not very real, ready. I will not explain. I hear just conditions in which accidentally or accidentally we run into such people. And that happens, it looks so strange. How we should run into such people? That I'm the manifester, and that's the nature of the lineage at least. Having my wife as friend, we will become a human being, with consciousness as well as everybody, and has become one with the Lord. Have you ever been with somebody who was very in consciousness, in awareness, in a spirit of oneness with the Lord? Have you ever been with him? If you are such a one, you definitely have the following characteristics. And it is called those characteristics, which can be used vertically from the spirit of oneness. You don't say that you have to look for a person.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.